this was basically, and additionally, the focal cavitation continued. And what we thought was a cavitary pneumonia due to probably TB was probably this child had multiple infarcts at different points of time, and these infarcted areas had developed cavity. So we proceeded with investigation. This child had antiphospholipid antibodies positive, was started on Clexane. He had two more episodes of the sudden onset breathlessness and oxygen requirement while in the hospital. And we did find more emboli subsequently. And thrombolysis was also needed with Altipase. And the child was started with dosage of steroids along with Clexane. And child was put on warfarin subsequently and regular follow-up with the team, and he did clinically well. The child was subsequently followed up for almost a year and a half, and so far he's been doing well. He's clinically stable and has had no problems subsequent to this. So we had a diagnosis, obviously, of pulmonary embolism, antiphospholipid antibody positive, and probably a secondary pulmonary hypertension due to all these events, cardiac and respiratory events that this child had. So obviously a good history that we had missed, probably pneumonias that were occurring on both sides. Some in the second episode when he was admitted with us was a persistent pneumonia. And we also, there was no signs of immunodeficiency, structural anomalies, reflux or anything in this child. But definitely for us, the diagnostic modality here was a CT with the contrast. And of course, we need to rule out common conditions first and think out of the box when your child is not improving. So it took us a long time to get to our diagnosis. And of course, this was a unique case, and we learned a lot from this one particular child. Second child is a five-month-old baby brought to our pediatric emergency. Fever and cough. Hello? For last 2 months.
Hello.
Fever for about 10 days, cough 10 days, rashes on the body, breathing fast 3 days, chest retractions for 2 days. So this is the pattern this child had. Was absolutely well for 3 months. Then in between had 7 days of fever, cough and cold, symptomatic management. 10 days was well. Again, 10 days later, fever, cough, fast breathing, antibiotic nebulization. 8 days in between was better, and then this current admission. So this is basically like a, almost like a 20 a month. In a month, this child over 5 weeks. This was the third episode of respiratory suspected respiratory tract infection. Out of the previous attack episodes, one episode required hospitalization and IV antibiotics. So this child's been having high-grade fever, 10 days, and very progressive high-grade fever rash. After the fever, and on the finger, face, trunk, extremities, no palms and soles were spared, and cough was always present throughout the day, and this child was breathing fast and had a lot of noisy breathing, not feeding well, very, very lethargic child. In the past, there was no history of any bluish discoloration or excessive sweating, abnormal suck-rest cycles, no ear discharge, choking, aspiration, fatty stools, failure to gain weight. And as I said, he had had nebulizations, antibiotics in another local hospital. I remember this child had flown in from another state after receiving 5 days of antibiotics. And in the past, term child, cesarean, but 2.8 kg, nothing very significant. And this is the index child, no past history and family. There was nothing suggestive of any major issues and no history, antenatal or postnatal history that was suggestive. Exclusively breastfed, no problems with feeding, and the milestones were all good. Immunization all till the time this child was well, the child was immunized for that age. So we have this child who's 5 months old, a male child, non-consanguineous and thriving well, but now has come with three episodes. This current one is very, very, very sick. So we are wondering whether, what is it? Is it a bacterial pneumonia? Why is this child having these recurrent episodes? This child has come in respiratory distress. So you're looking at etiologies, before I show you more, the subsequent diagnostic tests? Are we looking at the child who's shunting? Is it a cardiovascular problem? Are we looking at airway malformations like tracheostomy fistula? Is it a child with cleft? Is this child aspirating? Is it some congenital anomaly that we're missing? Is it a ciliary dysfunction, right? But this child was not having failure to thrive, had past meconium. Is it could be something as cystic fibrosis? None of these had, this child had no pointers towards any of these illnesses. Is it immunodeficiency? This child was thriving well, BCG scar was present, cord fall was normal, and there was no vaccine reaction in the past, right? But this child had recurrent symptoms, was very sick now, this fever was very high grade, and maybe we are also not being able to tackle with the right antibiotics, but there was no other risk factors. So the child came in tachycardic, poorly perfusing, hypotensive, tachypneic, hypoxic, and was febrile when the child was brought in. And pallor was there. And other than this was the skin rash, which was macular erythematous rashes, which were nodular lesions all over. Weight was on the 10th centile, length between 10th to 25th, and height on the 25th centile. Child was, yes, in distress with a flaring, suprasternal subcostal retractions. Air entry was decreased in the left infraaxillary regions. Bronchial breathing was evident and crepitations, particularly on the left side. Liver was also palpable, 4 centimeters below the costal margin. The span was 9 centimeters and it was a hyperdynamic apex beat. CNS, the child was drowsy, whether it was because of sepsis or otherwise. Pupils were reacting well and the AF levels were pulsatile. So basically we had a child with probably a left lower lobe consolidation and hepatosplenomegaly, incomplete respiratory failure and shock. And this child probably partially immunized. So we were thinking, is it, we need to rule out HIV? Are we looking at some malignancies? Again, the more intense, more further diagnostic, is it HLH, LCH? What is it that we, or it's just another, it is a primary immunodeficiency. So now we see that anemia is 8.7, counts are 9,810. Considering the child was so sick, he was not mounting a good response. What was remarkable was his lymphocytes were at 0.6. So this was a profound lymphopenia. Platelet was good. In fact, was thrombocytosis. CRP was 130. Procal was 26.2. Rest of the markers for LFT and urea, creatinine, and all these were unremarkable. And this was the X-ray. So this child had obviously a very bad pneumonia, as it evident on the X-ray. The left hemithorax is completely
with
consolidation, and the heart looks, the heart size and the shape and everything looks quite well-centered and quite normal, but I think it's a massive pneumonia which is occupying the left side, almost occupying the left and sparing a little bit of the left lower as well as the left upper. So we have pneumonia that's completely in this entire zone. So when we got the HIV test, it was negative. And immunoglobulins were remarkable. IgG was 28, IgM was 13, and A and E were 18 and 3. So we know that this is definitely both the IgG as well as the IgM were low. Anemia had was already there, as well as lymphopenia. The blood cultures grew nothing. Initially cons, but subsequently no growth. Urine, stool had rotavirus. Exciton samples from body fluids were all negative. The gastric aspirate and a gene expert both were positive for AFP, and the skin biopsy showed AFP. So basically, this was a diagnosis of SCID with a severe pneumonia bacterial with a disseminated mycobacterial query BCG infection with respiratory failure and in septic shock. So SCID is something that we can still miss despite our best efforts. And incidence of disseminated TB is usually seen in 50% of the SCID patients. So this child, pneumonia, as well as the skin lesions, the gastric aspirate picked up the AFP, as well as the skin lesions also were positive for AFP. This third child is 2.5-year-old child, boy, cough for the last 2 weeks, non-productive, non-spasmodic, intermittent cough, not much of diurnal variation, fever for the last 8 days, spiking every 6 to 8 hourly, responding well to the paracetamol, fast breathing now for the last 2 days. So they were treated with oral antibiotics, then changed to IV in another hospital, and chest x-ray showed right upper lobe consolidation, but the child had symptoms of fever, cough, distress, and hence was referred to our hospital. And in the past, the child was a term appropriate for gestational age, 2.7 kgs, postnatally uneventful, no prior past hospitalization, nothing significant in the past. Family, it's a firstborn child, non-consanguinity, no past history of any significant in history in the family, developmentally, immunization, all this is absolutely normal. Child was febrile, was looking sick, the high temperature and saturations were 85 to 90%, had pallor and nothing. Apart from the pallor, does desaturations. This was the findings of this child with high respiratory rate of 60 to 70. So obviously a lot of respiratory distress, flaring of ale nasi, tachypnea, retractions. Chest movements were reduced on the right upper chest. The percussion node was dull on the right infrascapular and mammary and axillary areas, with air entry decreased on that side. Bronchial breathing was evident, inspiratory crepes bilaterally. And so all these findings were predominantly on the right side. He had a tachycardia, but no murmurs. And a complete blood count showed a count of 10,480. Hemoglobin was 9.8, PCB of 29.6, platelet count was normal. It was a normocytic hypochromic anemia, few macrocytes, few target cells, and probably a iron deficiency anemia. CRP was high. Blood gases were again unremarkable. And initially, the potassium was on the higher side, but eventually it was 4.5. Blood cultures were negative, and this was the X-ray. So all the findings confirm, again, it was a right upper lobe, right middle lobe. It's a pneumonia, and this was the X-ray that this child had. Oxygen was started with a non-rebreather mask at 10 liters, shifted to ICU, and then again on high flow oxygen. We had started the child on Miro, Vanc, and azithromycin because the child had already received antibiotics in another hospital. He had severe, the distress continued, respiratory rates were high, and we had to again switch to BiPAP. The counts were more or less on the higher side. The hemoglobin kept dropping. So we have a drop in the hemoglobin 7.8. The CRP is 214. So what continues is the pneumonia and the hemoglobin is dropping. So the hemoglobin further went down to 6.8 and we had to transfuse, and then further for 5.9. And so we started the investigations for hemolysis, the direct antiglobulin test, LDH, reticulocyte count, cold agglutinins. So LDH was 409, cold agglutinins were negative. The corrected reticulocyte was 0.2, and the DAT test, the IgG, as well as the CD3 was positive. So we have been, the drop started 9.4, 7.8, 6.8, and then 5.9. And it dropped despite of our using giving the red blood cell transfusion. But post this, when we investigated and realized that yes, there is a hemolysis ongoing, and so this is the X-ray again, and it showed status quo. The findings were status quo. Subsequently, the distress was better. BiPAP was again converted to high flow, and we could continue. Meropenem and the vancomycin were continued. Ultrasound thorax, we had to repeat because we want to see whether there's fluid, anything else. There was some paraneumonic pleural effusion and consolidation persisted, and we had to give IVIG and again transfuse for the RBC. Post IVIG, the child's hemoglobin picked up dramatically from 5.9 and with a transfusion, and all other parameters settled. High flow was stopped, and this child was able to shift out. So this is what was happening initially, you know, the high grade fever, spiking fevers reaching to 102, not hitting the baseline. So this was very, it was, the fevers continued despite of whatever we did. So after we shifted the child, again, the fever continued. The CRP, yes, was better, but again, 146, 111, CT chest, we had to plan again, and it showed a right necrotizing pneumonia with empyema, and we were worried, are we missing something else? Was it some CCAM with some superadded infection, even though the presentation of this child is a much older child, and the PCR grew strep pneumo, right? So we have a child who already had some hemolysis requiring transfusion, IVIG, and the fever persisting, and PCR again even now has picked up a strep pneumococcus. And look at the CT, as horrendous as it looks, and it was a severe necrotizing pneumonia, practically covered the entire upper mid zones, a lot of thickened empyema on the, as is evident here, the entire lung is almost, you know, like bullet holes. So this was the all the lobes of the lung were affected. This child had to go for a thoracotomy, decortication, evacuate the empyema, lung debridement, and we were very worried that, you know, this child would have problems. But we continued with the antibiotics, and subsequently we were able to get the child better, fever spikes reduced, and dramatic improvement. So this is post-surgical intervention. You can see just hit the baseline, like, you know, dramatically. And there were some glitches of low-grade fever, but these were due to the thrombophlebitis, and the child subsequently improved. And you can see the post-thoracotomy decortication procedures, this child's lung absolutely improved within 2 to 3 weeks, and the child did well and managed to be sent home. Right, so we had no further hemolysis counts, all CRP came down, and then we could send him. But this child had a course of stay in the hospital for almost 5 weeks, and it was really a difficult time for this child. This is a fourth child.
Can we break in between the cases to have some better interaction? I mean, it will make more interesting. We can ask you questions.
Sure. So basically, but you know, this is my last case, so we can always go back. Can we do that?
In that case, we'll have to go back to the first case, start discussing again, which will be
Rick Holmes. Sure.
Go with the case and then discuss and have some thought process. You can ask the delegates what they think. I think that will make, I'm sure you have given a fantastic three cases there. It itself might take 3 hours to discuss, but at least few homes.
Yeah,
few
take home at
least, which will be very useful.
Yeah. So,
do you think we should, Sagar, what do you think?
Sure, yes, I'm problem. Okay to do that. No problem.
Yeah, because this particular case which you showed as a resistant pneumonia, I mean, do you think it was bacterial? What you think in terms of the whole course of presentation? This case was started, cough as a presentation going on for 2 weeks, and then fever started, right? This was the start of the case, was cough for 1 week. Later on, he started fever, and then he became breathless in last 2 days. That's what there was a presentation. I mean,
The first case?
No, this particular case. We'll go back to the first case later on.
Oh.
Particular case, if you see the first slide of presentation.
Okay.
Okay. I was wondering whether we are looking at some airway problem, since he had come only with cough without fever for almost a week. A well-grown child, 2.5 years old, who comes with only cough for first 1 week, and then gets fever and then later on become breathless. I was wondering whether we are dealing with some problem, maybe like a foreign body or something, or maybe an aspiration syndrome. And
yes,
first 1 week, yes, fever at all. Why do I think of infection at all in this child? I was just wondering whether there's something underlying which later on got infected. How do you look at this presentation?
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah, I think this was what we also felt, that, you know, did we miss a foreign body? Did we miss something else? Because, and the kind of necrotizing pneumonia that the child had, right? Subsequently. And did we miss a foreign body or something like that? That was also our first, when we started the discussion on this case, that was also what we thought. But as we progress along, the, you know, the child requiring transfusion, then the strep pneumococcus that came along with the as we proceeded. So these were things that, and we even thought, was it a CCAM that got infected? Though it is such a far-fetched diagnosis. Yeah.
What are the cause of dropping hemoglobin in this child? This was strep pneumonia. Is it known in strep pneumonia to have such a significant drop in hemoglobin? But I was thinking whether it is mycoplasma coming on the way.
Yes. But so the cold, so we did the cold agglutinin titers, and that was negative for mycoplasma. And so there are not many cases of strep pneumococcus causing this kind of hemolytic anemia. And in fact, when we see hemolytic anemias with pneumonias, it's usually mycoplasmas, right?
But this particular was not hemolytic. Retic also was corrected. Retic was just 0.2. So this was not hemolytic.
Yeah, it is not the classic. I mean, it doesn't fit into the. But this child was the, when we did the whole agglutinins for mycoplasma, it was negative.
Yeah.
And yeah.
The last question related to this is: will you work this child for immunoglobulin like Bruton's, because he's kind of resistant and persistent and requiring something started with more of airway and subsequently caught up with infection which progressed and become resistant. So will he be doing his immunoglobulin levels? Something like Bruton's can come, something like this? IgG can come like this? Persistent pneumonia going beyond?
Yes. So, yeah, thank you for that question. This child, we did work up. I didn't put it in the slides. All the immunoglobulin palette, everything was normal for this child. And we also thought, you know, because the infection took so long, almost 5 weeks for us to, you know, and despite of all our antibiotics, despite of active interventions, we were not able to get that pneumonia under control right from the start.
Yeah. Can I intervene something?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So this case, as Eileen, a very interesting case. So any cough which is going for 2 weeks, we usually think about airway disease. But whenever there is a fever coming, and after 2 weeks or 1 week fever, cough also, you have to think about the bacterial causes. Mm-hmm. And streptococcus, I have seen two cases. Streptococcus definitely causes not significant hemolysis, but I have seen cases where hemoglobin dropping, because hemoglobin dropping over the period of time. So you may not get a retic count, higher retic count or something like that, but definitely this is very well known. When I contacted Dr. S. Balasubramaniam, he said streptococcus and hemolysis is very, very common phenomena. So whenever there is a dropping hemoglobin, think about streptococcus, one of the causes of your pneumonia.
Yeah. So yeah, and streptococcus, of course, what we see more frequent is strep with the HUS, right?
Yes.
But that would come with AKI and, you know, all the other features of hemolysis. And but in this child, we didn't have that.
But again, the corrected retic in this child was 0.2. So do you think hemolytic or non-hemolytic?
Yes, yes.
But it was non-hemolytic going by the
number. Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay. The first two cases we'll discuss later. You can finish the fourth case and then we'll go to those cases.
Okay.
Yeah.
So our last case, and so we have a 6-week-old child from Mauritius who was apparently well till 3 weeks of age, but was having difficulty in feeding, suck cycle, increased sweating while feeding, fast breathing following feeding. The child progressively had increasing symptoms, history of cough for about 2 weeks, and it was not related to feeds, no postursive vomiting, but was progressively increasing. And what the mother noticed was a lot of chest retractions for 4 days and with grunting for the subsequent 2 days. So we have a 6-week-old child who was okay till 3 weeks. Then you have the entire problems with feeding, sweating excessively, and these problems are worse. Apart from that, the cough starts, and then after that, chest retractions and grunting. No past history of any cyanosis, noisy breathing, regurgitation, anything, choking on feeds. No, no fever, no seizures. And so we have a preterm, almost a 34-weeker. Caesarean was done because it was IVF. And child had respiratory distress and surfactant was given. Antenatally, nothing significant, non-consanguineous. I mean, for that few weeks of age, he was normal and immunized, and of course he was breastfed. And we were thinking, definitely there was an element of cardiac issue. Is there an additional respiratory, a bigger respiratory issue, or was it just pure sepsis? So he had 144, his pulse was 140, BP 80 by 60, respiratory rate were high, 66, saturations were 60 to 70 on room air, and he required a lot of, he required 10 liters of oxygen via hood. He was afebrile, height, weight on the 15th centile, head circumference on the 3rd centile, and he had head bopping, nasal flaring, grunting, he was cyanose. Nothing, no obvious dysmorphism, and the spine and the genitalia were normal. He had his apex beat in the left intercostal space, no visible scars, and of course, it was a hyperdynamic apex. Thrill was also present, and on auscultation, he had a pansystolic 3x6 murmur, and best was heard in the tricuspid, and it was a loud P2. So it's obvious he has a CVS problem as well. And chest movements were decreased only on the left side. And there was a dull node on the left side and poor entry on the left side. And no bronchial breathing, no Krebs or ronchi. Just the air entry was decreased. The movement was decreased on the left side. And The liver was not palpable. The rest of the systemic examination was normal. CNS was again normal. And so we thought that, is it some CVS, a primary CVS with a respiratory problem, or a respiratory with a primary respiratory with an underlying cardiac problem? So this was the X-ray. And as we can see, there's just uniform haziness of the left side of the lung. Crowding of the ribs compared to the other side. The diaphragm looks like they're both on the same level. My cardiac right heart border is not seen, it's shifted. And there's some infiltrates on this side of the chest, on the left side. And So this is what we saw on the X-ray. Subsequently, it's status quo, this X-ray. It doesn't look worse, but it's kind of, it looks like similar findings. So this is just for like a comparison when we're talking about, is it a hypoplastic lung? Is it a collapse? So, so if you have a collapsed lung, you'll have crowding, you'll have a mediastinal shift, whereas a hypoplastic lung, you can still see the cardiac border may not shift completely. And do you see any other lung shadows on the chest? So versus a collapse, this is just a 2 X-rays just for comparison. So we were wondering, is it a complete collapse of the lung? Is it a hypoplastic lung? So on the echo, it was a large OS-ASD with a large PDA right to left shunt, dilated pulmonary arteries. And what was remarkable is they could not find the LPA, and it was a left-sided pulmonary veins were not clearly visible, and there's a right ventricular dysfunction. So obviously this child has a very big ASD and a large PDA with shunting, pulmonary arteries are dilated. But what was remarkable is we couldn't see this on the echo. The cardiologist felt that he couldn't locate this well. And then when we did the scopy, we could not navigate through the left bronchus. Even with the child intubated, we could not navigate at all on the left side. Like, we just couldn't pass the scope on that side. Sorry, this video is not playing. And so we straight away decided to do a CT angio. And what is really, really obvious is we see the trachea here, the right side, the left side, and there's a complete cutoff in the middle here. So there is some cutoff here and there is some cutoff here, but we're not sure. But this is just one section of the scan, so it wasn't very clear what was happening. But what this child had was the LPA was arising from the RPA. So the LPA was arising, the left pulmonary artery was arising from RPA on the posterior aspect. And it had a tortuous course to the left hilum, and hence this was compressing the left main bronchus, right? So this was what was happening to our child. And this is a classic case of a bridging bronchus. And even though it's rare, it's usually associated with congenital heart defects. Incidence is really 0.1%. Our baby had this bridging bronchus, the type B, right? This one, this child had, because even the scope, we couldn't pass the scope beyond this. It's just a dead end. And the entire left lung was collapsed because this was completely a very narrow extrinsic compression of the airway. So this child was obviously the ASD with a PDA, severe pulmonary artery hypertension, RV dysfunction, and this abnormal origin and of course of the LPA resulting in the compression of the left main bronchus, and this was a case of bridging bronchus. So I'll just stop here and maybe can take discussions for this case.
Sagar, you want to start?
Yeah, no, sir, you start.
Any, yeah.
So anybody, delegate want to ask questions?
Bridging bronchus actually is a very rarity. To my knowledge, only 22 cases are reported in the literature. In fact, why I know that? Because recently, last week only, we saw one.
Okay.
And which was primarily, we did a scope, and this was a very interesting scope it was. Hmm. Like, this is just a 1.5 month baby referred to me for respiratory distress, and he had imperforate anus at birth, operated at 3 weeks, sent home. And during that course also, baby had some breathing difficulty. Anesthetist said it could be mucus plug and all. And they discharged the baby at 18th day. After 2 weeks, the baby was brought with distress. And then was sent to us for probable associated upper airway and all. And he was having classical biphasic stridor. So we put in a scope. And I got 3.5 pentax flexi. That I could not negotiate half trachea wide. Something which I was thinking it was trachea. So up to half, I could negotiate. Beyond that, I could not go. I was wondering why the trachea is so long. Then I took my 2 millimeter telescope, which went beyond that. And then I could see the carina far beyond that. I was just wondering what exactly is that. And with that kind of things, we took help of an airway person. And then they did the CT contrast and all those things. And then found to be a right, on a CT, first CT, it was right bronchus was just at the original and there was complete disconnective between. But then on detailed contrast screening, they found the right bronchus is not existing and left main was giving a branch to right side. So your type 4 perhaps, which was giving a right side disease. So that's part of ventral anomaly and multiple other effects were there. So something like type 4, where your left main was giving a branch to the right this is airway, right lung totally. Right upper lobe was agenetic and right lung was developed, which was supplied by the branch coming from the left main bronchus.
Yes.
And, the one which was I was thinking as a stenostrachea was actually a left main bronchus below that, where I could not negotiate my 3.5. So I had to put in a telescope which was 2 millimeter. So it's a very rarity. Perhaps now the airway person is looking after it. I don't know whether parents will accept to operate or something. But that's a very complex kind of a scenario. Yes. Many times very difficult.
So probably, so probably we'll need some slight tracheoplasty or something like that to relieve extrinsic compression, right?
Yeah. I just wanted to ask you about your first case we go back to. One with what you said, that case was?
The boy.
Apla syndrome. Apla syndrome.
Yeah, the 13-year-old boy, right?
Yeah, that's right.
The first case, yeah.
Yeah. I was wondering that case, as I thought it was something like Wegener's coming up. Wegener's sometimes comes like the vascular syndromes. They come with respiratory and later on they turn out to be nephritic or something.
Yes.
And I was wondering whether you would go for the, you will tell me some hematuria comes up there. But Apla is, Apla is almost like presentation is same. You've got a multiple vascular clogging because of.
Yes.
But coming at 13 years is a bit unusual. They call it as CAPS, the catastrophic Apla syndromes, which can come with this kind of a rare presentation. And many times they come more of a limb gangrenes because of the blocks. I've seen
vascular thrombotic events.
Yeah. So they were more of a limb thrombosis and gangrene. I've seen two cases, in fact, but they came very early in the life. This was 13 years. I was wondering whether this secondary something like SLE or something is coming up. And they may be associated
syndrome. So he was worked up. So everybody worked up for the SLE and the lupus association, then various Doppler scans for his DVT or any other thrombotic events. Neurological sequelae was followed up.
But
this child did well. But yes, we did miss the diagnosis in the beginning. Several times we missed a diagnosis.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
No, because you didn't do the CT scan earlier. CT with contrast would have given.
No,
but when do you do CT with the contrast? You don't do with each and every child, right?
I know, but that's what I'm saying. Patient comes to me only when they have done the CT with contrast. And so early period, they don't do USG chest if repeated episodes of pneumonia is there. They do CT scan.
Yeah.
So Agar, for us,
Agar, something interesting is if this child comes to you now, you will go for a COVID workup. He's looking like Coronary score 10. See that CT?
Yes.
Multiple Coronary score 10, 12, something like that. So one baby is focusing on that. So that's very unusual. But yes, we have seen those kind of. One more interesting thing in that case was a shifting pneumonia, left side, right side.
This was on the left side predominantly, and then again on the right side, right? Then we also thought could it be some foreign body shifting here and there?
Foreign body.
We even thought. Later on we realized when the father told us that the pain initially, this pain that was there when he came in with the pain over the left shoulder and left back, right?
Yeah, that was the
problem. This was a pain that was
true.
He was given painkillers. And it was not related to breathing. Later, the father told us, related to breathing also. And it was so painful. So probably he had infarcted right at that time. And the infarcts developed into pneumonia. So we kept treating the pneumonias.
Wegener's can fool you like that. I have seen one Wegener's who behaved exactly like that. I was just wondering whether you're showing us a Wegener's.
Yes.
And your second case was an interesting one, definitely. Something. I was thinking it was a histiocytosis classical, which was coming with those skin lesions. Histiocytosis typically has those skin lesions and hepatosplenomegaly with recurrent respiratory. I'm just wondering but that turned out to be a SCID. Interesting.
So, but this child, unfortunately, respiratory failure, and we were planning for the, stem cell, all those things, but we lost this child.
So, similar, second case you discussed, similar case right now in Apollo, the child had bilateral with skin lesions and nodules. This came out to be tuberculosis for your case, but my case, I forgot the name also. It's a Blau syndrome. We got it on clinical exam sequencing and it is nothing but early sarcoidosis. Now today only we got the diagnosis. I did scopy for the child in thinking because this child has flown from Kenya. And we thought tuberculosis, HIV, immunoglobulin workup, everything came negative. Everything yeah. came negative. So clinical, this one sequencing is exon sequencing is very, very useful in such cases. But and you have to do extensive workup until unless you get this type of rare diagnosis. But,
Sagar.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Sagar, Dr. Bhandarkar here. Madam, oh, there was a clue in the CBC in the immunodeficiency patient. It was a classical lymphopenia.
Lymphocyte was low.
Yes.
Normally, you should get all this. Our pediatric patients have a large number of lymphocytes. You should go for a absolute lymphopenic count. Suppose there is lymphopenia less than 600 something, you should suspect immunodeficiency.
Less than 2,500. Less than 2,500.
Right. That's that is number. I think Dr. Mohita has presented 4 or 5 years one back such case. Skid. And he misled to cystic fibrosis, but was the immunodeficiency, right? Two cases were there. One was cystic fibrosis. Another was the immune deficiency. But
oh,
right?
Yes, yes. Oh, we had a skid like that. You're right. But as I had said, this child's presentation, the skin presentation with hepatitis splenomegaly with recurrent respiratory at that age, my first bet, if I don't see any report, will be histiocytosis.
Yes.
True.
Hey, but suppose there is hepatitis splenomegaly, you should suspect T-cell deficiency. That is very common. They can present also, but with hepatitis splenomegaly. They are that classical presentation. When this patient has absolute lymphopenia, there is another major clue in the diagnosis on simple CBC.
So that was the CBC was very, very crucial for that diagnosis of that child with SCID.
This is one question in chat box. What are the cutoff levels of immunoglobulin to call it as immunodeficiency? Anybody? Cutoffs for immunoglobulin to say it's immunodeficiency.
They are given on the report.
I thought you will answer, sir. I thought you will answer.
No, you can't remember them, honestly.
Yeah, we have given it in the chat box.
They are given in the report itself. But the important thing is at time they can be fallacious, especially when the child is so sick. You can have pan-hypohemoglobulinemia.
Yes.
Even for that matter, flow cytometric reports also can cheat. So at Wadia, what we do is we repeat those reports once the child is completely recovered. Maybe at least 4 to 6 weeks down the line. So sometimes even 3 months later, even if you have those abnormal reports, we won't straight away go with the management. We'll stabilize the child, treat the infection. And then after 6 to 8 weeks, we repeat the reports. And then if that shows the same thing, then it is labeled as immunodeficiency. Not just at acute severe stage.
Yes. Yeah. Because even for our child, we also thought that we have to repeat this because, and we actually repeated it. And we thought that with this kind of clinical picture, when the child came so sick, we may be in misinterpreting, the whole picture. But in this case, the AFB, the skin nodules, the entire clinical picture went in favor of the SCID.
Okay. Hello. I wanted to ask, in empyema, when you should go ahead for early surgical interventions, like what are the conditions in which you can think about, early intervention like VATS or otherwise this child would have earlier could have gone for VATS. It was better than thoracotomy.
Or even a fibrinolysis.
It was a difficult case, but this is a general question, like when should we get the child surgical interventions?
Yeah.
What are the today's guidelines, you may say? I mean, what is your course of interventions in case of confirmed empyema? Suppose it comes to you firsthand with a fever of 4 or 5 days and the child become breathless. How do you document empyema? What will be your course of interventions at this point first? And then maybe ICD is first or what? I mean, what is your, how do you follow? Which are the cases where you will straight away go with a surgical rather than even ICD? Is there such kind of category, subset of patients?
So, I think, Sagar, you want to take that or?
No, first you take, then I'll, if at all, anything required.
Yeah, so I think clinically, yes. The most important thing in a child who's not responding to the what we do in clinical practice is when a child is not responding to your antibiotics, either there is fluid or there's pus or you're on the wrong antibiotics, right? These are the three most important things when you're looking at a child with pneumonia, right? So with the kind of investigative thing that we have, we usually start with the ultrasound. That's the safest, most invasive test to see whether there's fluid or not. Clearly, if we already have loculations or pockets coming up or septations that are evident, then we are definitely more guarded. In fact, in our center, the minute we just have minimal septations, we also try fibrinolysis. We do instillations of the fibrinolytic drugs. And after that, we repeat the ultrasound. And then if the child is not clinically improving, the ultrasound is showing worsening, then definitely that child definitely will need a procedure. It's VATS. And most commonly, it's a video-assisted thoracoscopy. In this particular child of ours, because the child had such a bad CT, not only was it necrotizing pneumonia, we also had empyema, we had fluid pockets everywhere, and hence this child had to be subjected to decortication. So I would say in clinical practice, very few of our patients have landed up with decortication. Most would be managed with VATS if it's a procedure that's required for the empyema.
So does tuberculosis have septation, and can tuberculosis present like that? Not presentation, but can have sequelae in the response, because I have you seen in your practice? Because I have one kid on AKT for almost 4 months, developed septations and pockets everywhere. And right now he's in Wadia, undergone the decortication. And after decortication, the report says rifampicin resistance. Oh, and what is your experience in that case? You know, how many tuberculosis patients after starting AKT also gone into, decortication or like this procedure? Because they should usually improve with the AKT.
I haven't seen many cases. The last case was years ago when I worked during my MD days in Kalavati, where we had so many patients of TB, was probably the last time we have put in a chest drain in a child of TB.
TB, yeah.
Thereafter, I have not. Most of the TB effusions are well managed with the if we are starting ATP on time. So I don't know about, maybe Dr. Mahesh and the others would be able to give us more, you know, insights to this. But because once we put a drain in a TB child, then it is really, really going to be tough.
I believe the pathology is different here. It's not a classical pleural effusion of TB, which is an immunological effusion, typical with which we talk about, which comes after 5 to 6 years of age. This one is a tubercular empyema.
Yes.
This is an extension of the tubercular pneumonia, like a bacterial pneumonia. Getting into empyema, this is tubercular pneumonia getting worse. So it's a pus. Once it is pus, you can have pus to be drained. You will have the septations. Will behave like any other empyema, where you will require drain. The classical TB pleural effusion that we talk about is an immunological reaction, which is the richest focus, which just breaks few bacteria bacilli into the pleura. And this child, typical child, which is having a focus and localized infection, is immunocompetent. So it's a hyperimmune response which fills the pleura, which don't require anything. Just treat him with anticoax and he does well. One which you're talking about perhaps is a tubercular empyema. Extension of the infection pneumonia into pleura. So it's a pus which is there, which has to be done. Once it is pus, it has to be drained. So that's how perhaps it is.
Yeah.
What is our take on the VAT, early VAT? Early VAT intervention is, say, the septation.
That's what she said now. Suppose a child is not improving with your proper antibiotic course, and so in fact the respiratory distress or his fever is not settling down. Fever is not the only criteria, but otherwise also general condition like
inflammatory markers
not coming down,
antibiotic usage,
just UHG chest showing the septation or loculation, then if early septation which are moving, you know, it shows on UHG that it's moving. If it is moving, then you can go ahead with your fibrinolytics, but it's not moving loculated, immediately go for VATS. So that is the criteria.
I have a question, not about this case, about the previous case of this alpha, that is the that thrombus, right? Madam, alpha, when we go for a X-ray, one of the radiological, when you go for sonography, whether you're able to detect that thrombus on the sonography, right? Is it possible?
So to detect the thrombus on our ultrasound would be very technically, and I mean, it's very difficult to detect the thrombus on ultrasound.
Impossible.
Ultrasound would be the best, the best results for ultrasound would be for fluid and all these loculations. And for the thrombus, I would say it would be difficult to detect that.
For a simple logical reason, the vessels which are lodging the thrombus are deep seated, and there is an intervention of lung in between. And
the parenchyma in between.
Parenchyma, that lung cannot be penetrated. The air cannot be penetrated by ultrasonic.
Yeah.
So you can't get any.
And even though, like in this particular patient, we saw infarcts in the periphery, right? There are multiple infarcts in the periphery. Even then, the ultrasound would not be the best modality to pick up these peripheral infarcts.
Because ultrasound can pick up pneumonia even before started on the X-ray, right? Even that changes can be earlier, can be picked on the sonography. So I just thought whether it can be possible in this. Okay.
I suppose ultrasound is also very user dependent, and I think it would be a very well trained sonologist and with a good amount of expertise, maybe in those cases.
Right.
You used IVIG in one of those cases. What was the what are the rationale?
This one. The
One the with the resistant pneumonia, perhaps with the hemoglobin dropping.
Yeah.
Second one, yeah.
Yeah. Why it was used? IVIG.
The second case, right? No.
Yes, second case.
One with the resistant pneumonia, I suppose.
This one.
It's the third case. One with the resistant pneumonia.
Third case.
2.5-year-old boy with cough for 2 weeks, fever for 1 week, breathless last 2 days. And he went on to develop resistant pneumonia. We did DCOT later on. But prior to that, with the dropping hemoglobin, we used IVIG. Actually, it was not hemolytic. It was not direct Coombe test. DCT was also just wondering why IVIG was used. Actually,
so this one, right?
Empty.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah.
So in this one, right? So this one, right? So only this IgG plus was positive, right? This direct Coombe's test, direct antiglobulin test.
Okay. That was positive. Okay.
So this was positive.
Okay.
So this was the reason. And so despite of us giving the transfusion, the hemoglobin dropped even further. So then we decided we do the DAT, LDH, retic count, and colagglutinin. So the colagglutinin was negative. We are not having a retic count was 0.2. So the only thing that was positive was the DATs. Then we gave the immunoglobulin, and then the child improved in terms of his hemoglobin.
So can the reason for drop in hemoglobin may be something different than the primary pathology that you're dealing with? So there was one thing.
Could it be infection related?
Because it's chronic, maybe.
But to see such a dramatic drop, as you can see, 1 day, 1, 3, 5, 7, the hemoglobin dropping like that. It's a bit unusual, right?
Yeah.
And even though we know that strep can cause hemolysis, strep pneumo can cause hemolysis, again, even that clinical picture was not fitting in here.
True. Unusual.
And it was not mycoplasma.
Right.
Yeah.
We had already given adequate azithromycin.
Yes, adequate azithromycin was given.
Though the resistant mycoplasma is very well known in India now, 40% they said oxycycline is the drug of choice now anyway.
Yes.
One more question on doxy for that.
Yes. And with mycoplasma, you can have a severe pneumonia and very, very little hemolysis, or vice versa, like a very mild pneumonia and severe hemolysis.
So even that,
it was not, the clinical picture was not that of, the mycoplasma.
Interesting. Thank you.
Any other questions? If anybody wants to ask.
It was an excellent session, Sagar. Madam, it was a very excellent session. I enjoyed.
There are no more questions. I would like to thank Eileen for reaching to us with this platform and giving us some enlightening thoughts about pneumonias. You took very common cases, not common cases, the common presentations which we as a pediatrician see, and how to go about think out of the box also, and common things common first, as well as you have to think out of the box when they are not going your way. And very important was the discussion, as usual, Dr. Mohite sir has put in inside these cases, and Dr. Bhandarkar sir also. Thank you very much for IIP Raigad for giving this opportunity. And I would like to ask Dr. Ingle madam, our president IIP Raigad, to say a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sagar. It was an excellent, different types of cases, bridging bronchus, I never heard of it before. Absolutely, very hutke case presentation, and I thank Dr. Iris madam for giving us insight into this. And thank you, Dr. Sagar and Dr. Mohite sir, for moderating the session so well. And thanks to Sanofi for organizing this session. And I express thanks from all the participants who have joined in. And thank you all.